And get started, and I really appreciate all you folks who came out tonight. We're supposed to have a lot more people, but a small and mighty group of people who is really going to do the work is, I've discovered, a lot better than a very large group of people who come to shake hands and have no intention of doing anything. So I congratulate you for showing up and your first step in your world of activism.
Thank you
very much for coming. My name is Andrea Miller, and I'm the Deputy Field Director for Progressive Democrats of America. I'm also the co-chair of the Virginia chapter of Progressive Democrats of America. One of the things that we are working on at PDA is we are really working and pressing to move the progressive agenda forward. So that means we are pressing for jobs, we are pressing for justice, we are pressing for peace. Tonight, we are going to be talking about jobs, how to get them, what legislation is currently before the Congress, what it's going to do or take for us to move that legislation forward. We're going to be talking about justice, budgets, or moral documents, and one of the things that's sitting in our way is we don't currently have a progressive budget, so we're going to be looking at what a progressive budget would look like and potentially talking about strategies on how to get one, fund our jobs program. We always have to at least spend a moment talking about single-payer universal health care, because one of the reasons that all of our states are broke and many other things are having no money is because of the exorbitant cost of health care and the fact that we have no way to control costs, even with the new legislation. So we're going to look at what is the obvious next step that we have to take. And then we'll probably spend a moment exploring the other incredibly obvious answer to how do we get more money, and that basically is, of course, peace. End the wars, end the occupations, and bring the $1 trillion war dollars home.
That's right.
So our very first panelist is Dr. Rayfield Vines from the NAACP. He is president of the Virginia State Conference of the NAACP, and one of the things I discovered when I read his bio, in addition to being a minister, is he is also a teacher, and he is also a musician. So we printed everybody's bio so that you could get to know our speakers, and we are now going to turn it over to Dr. Vines to share with us his vision. Dr. Vines.
Good evening, folks. Good evening. Before the night is gone, we'll probably get several ideas as to how to get people into jobs. My pet peeve is the idea of once the economy is healthy again and people are being hired, my end will be the restoration of rights. And the reason for that, as the president of the state of Virginia, that has been one of my main objectives, is to get the rights of felons restored. And I did some research on felony, and everything that I come up with suggests that this was a tactic to keep people from voting, etc., etc. Give you a true story. I had a cousin that called me just last week. He says, I had a felony in 2003, and I've been trying to get a job since that time, and every time it comes up, and I can't. I paid my dues. I've gone to do what I need to do. He's in theological school, if that helps anything. But at this point, he can't get a job, and so he's completely frustrated. So once the economy is healthy, and we are hiring people, felons still aren't hired. And one of the things that we've been talking about is to ban the box. And for those of you who may not be completely familiar with that, on the job application, there's a question that asks, have you been convicted of a felony? And if you say yes, 9 times out of 10, your application goes in file 13. You don't even get to the interview process. What we're suggesting is that we take that off of the application. We're not suggesting that the question not be asked, but take it off the application to give the applicant an opportunity to defend, and that person might be able to justify, and at least you get to the interview process. But with that question on the application, so many applications are never even looked at and you never get a call back. This whole business of restoration of rights, I hate to say it this way, but African American men are, it is disproportionate. I'm going to throw another chalk in the wheel when we're talking about it. And this is, I don't have time to talk about this tonight. The decriminalization of drugs. The drug war has not been successful. It has not been successful. The irony is that the dominant society uses drugs more than the African Americans, but more African American men are in jail with felony. Now, I hope that didn't hurt anybody. These are just raw facts. Because more African Americans are in jail and they get a felony, then they come out, they can't get a job. And then people wonder why they're standing on the corner. And then they get stereotyped. And it's not that they don't want jobs. It's that they went to a court that you had conservative judges who gave you a sentence disproportionate to the crime. And you got other people who come in who get a slap on the wrist or have a good lawyer and get no time. We need to deal with that. So while we're talking about jobs and jobs and jobs, okay, let's open the trial. We got 100,000 jobs available. How many African American men will qualify? I think we need to look at that piece. So that's where I am when it comes to creating jobs. This sounds good. It sounds good, but I'm on the end of that where it does not really play out when it comes to the African American man. So I think we do need to look at this whole thing of restoration of rights and then look at the possibility of African American men being employed. So when we talk about job creation, we've got to take that segment of the population, because even if we were to hire 10,000 people tomorrow, how many black men would qualify? I'll pass it on. If you have any questions.